and we have somebody really special for you. We have Professor Dr. Michael Weidner. He's the director of Fraunhofer Institute for Secure Information Technology. And he has a long history at IBM. He's a distinguished engineer and IBM's chief technology officer for security. And he's responsible for the technology, security, and architecture of all of the products of IBM. And he's going to go deep into the topic of taking a cybersecurity enterprise perspective today. So I hope you are as excited as I am for our next speaker. Please welcome to the stage Professor Dr. Michael Weidner. Thank you.
Hello.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. So I'm going to talk for the next 20 minutes, 25 minutes or so about what I call the reality of cybersecurity. And what I want to discuss with you, so there will be the opportunity to ask questions afterwards, what I want to discuss with you is how do we see from a research organization cybersecurity from an enterprise perspective. And at the end, I will also show you a few examples of what current research topics we have and how this looks like. Now, first slide, you have seen the same slide probably many times in different variations, but just to make this point, today everything is connected, everything is programmable, everything is open. That's the promise of the current IT, and this is the perfect prerequisite for attacking things. And everything that you see on this slide, from the top left, the data center to the connected car, bottom right, has been already hacked. If you want, I can give you an arbitrary number of examples. Some you see here in this little box, you see the prototypical attacks of the last, say, 20 years, from the Suse botnet to more recent things like the MyIFA wallet hijack. And I actually don't want to go into details behind this, we could, but the point is IT today is extremely easy to attack. Yeah, I mean, if you would talk to someone who is responsible for building planes, and planes would have the same safety as IT has security, you would probably refuse to get into these planes. Unfortunately, there's almost no risk for attackers. You can hide behind firewalls, behind proxies, behind anonymization networks. You can easily pretend to be someone else. You can easily mount false flag operations. And the logic is everything that seems to be worthwhile being attacked actually has been attacked. We see this in all sectors. If you look at the statistics, really everything is attacked. The attackers are typically cyber criminals, but also state-sponsored attackers. And attacks are increasingly automated. Yeah, it's not so that today we have the attackers sitting in the basement somewhere and doing nasty things. That's not true anymore. Maybe this was never true. Typically, this is an industry. It's highly automated. You can rent attacks. There is something called attack cybercrime as a service. All of this exists. And last point that I want to make before moving on to the next slide is the topic of attribution, finding out who is actually guilty, is extremely difficult. Yeah, so if someone tells you behind this attack there was, pick your most favorable country on earth, it's hard to really prove this from an IT perspective. A pure IT-based attribution is close to impossible. The real attribution, of course, does work. So if a Secret Service tells you this was probably country X, probably that's true, but then it's true because at the end there is standard intelligence behind it. Not the standard IT intelligence, but the real intelligence. And there's a very low sense of guilt. I mean, if you look around how attacks are happening, and also if you look at your own feelings, if you do something on the internet, the idea that you're doing something wrong, that criminals are doing something wrong, this is much lower developed than in the real world, in the real life. It's the real world, of course, but in real life. So the threshold that someone has to take in order to commit something like a cybercrime is much lower than in the physical world. Now, this is the situation. You can ask, and what are the real numbers? Do we actually do research in showing how bad the world is or how good the world is? And of course, we do, and many others do also. So what we do regularly is we scan mobile apps, so iOS and Android apps, to be more precisely, for known vulnerabilities, for whether they would meet enterprise requirements for being used in an enterprise. And we find that 81% of all popular free apps, they communicate in the clear. So they don't encrypt anything. And okay, actually this is maybe not so bad in many cases, but typically they also don't protect updates. So they get updates for themselves over the wire. This is not protected by cryptography. It can be easily changed. And if you as an attacker can change the update function of a mobile app, then of course it's open for arbitrary bad things. Now, you can ask, okay, mobile apps, these are apps which everybody can program in no time in their spare time. What about serious apps, serious software, business software, like what you all have on your laptops or what you're running your business on? And there, if you do a simple back of the envelope calculation, then you can show that at any point in time, something like a serious operating system has between 100 and 1,000 vulnerabilities which just need to be found. Yeah, I mean, it's interestingly, of course, there are updates, like Microsoft is doing it every Tuesdays, others are doing it a different schedule. But unfortunately, these update processes, they are almost a renewal process. Yeah? Whenever you make an update, you get as many vulnerabilities in as you get out. This is a strange effect at the moment, but the quality of business software is certainly better than the quality of mobile apps, but it's definitely not satisfactory. Now, internet infrastructure, maybe that's better. Probably you suspect it's not better. How does internet infrastructure look like? We actually have a couple of research projects where we measure the security of the whole internet. So we scan everything, literally everything. And for instance, we scanned the DNS infrastructure, the domain name service infrastructure, which is responsible, for instance, for guiding you when you type www.fraunhofer.de to actually our web servers. And we found that 73% of these so-called DNS resolution platforms, they are vulnerable. And these are actually not any. If you ask for any, then you get to the 90-something. These are enterprise-run DNS resolution platforms. Behind this is cache poisoning. If you know what cache poisoning is and how the DNS works, then you know if I can manipulate the DNS system, I can guide you actually wherever I want. Yeah, if I want to attack you while you log in to your company, I pretend that actually you go to your company, but in fact, I send you to a website that I set up. It looks exactly like a company website. You type in your credentials and you're lost, and you have no chance of figuring it out. Interestingly, since more than 15 years, there is a proposal how to improve security of DNS called DNSSEC. It's also deployed, not very heavily deployed, but it's used by many governments, by the top-level domains. And we also did an analysis of how DNSSEC, so the security extensions of DNS, how they are deployed and used, and we found that 66% of them actually don't work as they are supposed to work. So even the security mechanisms, because they are very difficult to configure, because they are very difficult to set up, they don't really offer any security. So the situation in the internet is actually quite complicated. How long does it take to identify that you have been attacked? Now, there was a recent study showing that it's now 99 days between the point in time where you are attacked and the point in time where it's figured out. This sounds like a long time. Actually, just a few years ago, it was a few hundred days. So the situation is improving, but of course, 99 days is not a very good situation. And if you ask how much is the damage, then I can give you any number. So then, for instance, Bitkom, they guessed that it's like 50 billion euro per year for Germany, but I mean, it's really hard to say. It's a big number, no doubt. It's probably comparable to, say, the damage due to car accidents, but nobody knows. So that's the situation in statistics. Why is this? Yeah, so I'm in computer science since for the last 30 years. So to speak, I'm co-responsible for the situation in computer science, and unfortunately, computer science, security in computer science is not a very mature field, I have to say. Yeah, we are doing many, many things right, but so to speak, in some sense, there are still some fundamentals missing. So what are the reasons for insecurity? Lack of risk awareness. Your customers might not be really interested in security, might not be really thinking about it. This is definitely improving. I mean, the last years I have seen a significant improvement in the sense of risk in business. Social engineering. Statistics show that if I call you, then about 50% of you would give me happily your password if I tell you that otherwise you will lose your data. Yeah, if I get you in a traumatic mode, if you're really afraid that you lose something, then most people switch off their brain and just do whatever someone tells them, and unfortunately, this works very well. Insiders are necessarily very powerful users. If you can corrupt an insider, if you are an insider, then of course, this is quite easy then for an attacker. There's a negative incentive through cost pressure. Yeah, I mean, if you're in the software business, then you probably know that if you are responsible for security, then your requirements, they are typically put behind many other requirements, because it's more important that the product looks nice, it does what it's supposed to do, it really offers the service that everybody expects, and security comes not first, but maybe not last anymore. It's also improved significantly, but it's not taken as important as it should be. Number five, limited market success of known technology. What I mean with this, actually, you can see in these statistics. So there's a general assumption that if enterprises, if companies would deploy the current state of cybersecurity technology and cybersecurity processes, best practices, they could probably cope with 80% of the currently successful attacks. I mean, this is not science, this is just an estimate, but a very often made estimate. And what you see here is actually what's behind. Yeah, I mean, like, how do companies in Germany behave? So you see, okay, device passwords, firewalls, antivirus, everybody has, but then it's going quickly down to below 50. Encryption, less than 50%. Encryption of email, less than 50%, and so on. If all of this would be used, then we would be in a much better shape. Low software quality. I mean, I already said it. What's behind this? This simply means that there is an almost constant number of vulnerabilities in big business software. And what you see here is the statistics, which I think I took from IBM, where you see the number of vulnerability disclosures per year. And you see it's around 8,000, 9,000. And this looks almost like a law of nature, but of course it's not a law of nature. Yeah? There's nothing that says that this has to be like it is. It just means that the security development processes in industry, in research, are not well designed enough. The technology for secure development, for security by design, is not sufficiently deployed to actually improve on the situation. I think there is a lot of things that need to be done in research, but also in practice, in enterprises. Good, so the last few points. Difficult integration and administration, of course, insufficient usability, and time to market pressures. So, what's the state of cybersecurity? What can be done? What should be done? What needs to be done? So I think the current information and communication technology is fundamentally insecure. This is unfortunately really true. The people in my research institute can probably break into almost anything if they try hard enough. And certainly cyber criminals can also do this. It's only a question, is it worthwhile breaking into these systems, or are there easier ways for criminals to get what they want? The good news is kind of the majority of today's successful cyber attacks could be stopped with current methods and technologies. And that's my next topic. Actually, research offers a huge potential for dealing with this last 20%. I mean, 80% is not a lot. And of course, if 80% of the current attacks would be stopped, then there would be new attacks deployed, new attacks used, just the threshold would be lifted. So research needs to help. And how do we do this? I mean, I'm standing here for a research institute in Darmstadt. I will talk about it in a second. What we do is we do research in security for the real world. And we call this security and privacy at large. What's behind this? So if you talk to researchers, I mean, there are many here. If you talk to researchers in academia, then typically security research covers with well-defined small security problems. There is a cryptographic protocol which is proven secure. There is an access control mechanism which is proven to be safe, and so on. But of course, the real world is complex, it's integrated, it's huge, it's really large. And what we want to do is we want to transform all of the technologies on the more left side that we have in research so that actually it works for the big systems, for a whole enterprise IT department, for a whole country, for a whole infrastructure, for whatever you have in mind. Who is us and what is this? What is the institute I'm standing here? Just briefly, so I'm the head of Fraunhofer Institute for Secure Information Technology. We are the leading institution for applied cybersecurity research in Germany, but there are a couple of other institutes in Fraunhofer. Fraunhofer overall has, I guess, like 1,000 or so people working in cybersecurity. We are located in Darmstadt, but also in Jerusalem and in Singapore. And most importantly, we are not doing this alone. So we are one of three cybersecurity centers in Germany, which are recognized by the federal government as the national cybersecurity centers. One is in Karlsruhe, one is in Saarbrücken, and this one, CRISP, is in Darmstadt, the Center for Research and Security and Privacy. It's jointly with Mayer University, Technische Universität, and another university in Darmstadt, Hochschule Darmstadt, and two Fraunhofer Institutes. And in the last few minutes, I just want to show you a few examples how, what we actually do and what research projects we have. And as a framework, so here you see kind of how IT looks like from a security perspective today. So it's a typical layered model. So you see the internet infrastructure at the bottom, then you have kind of the IT environment in the middle, the data, compute, software infrastructure. On top, you have the people, the processes, and the things, the cyber-physical systems. And then on top, information and service. Information is actually what's really there, what you see in blocks, in data, in databases, but already interpreted, and the service. From an attacker perspective, there are two attacks in cybersecurity, historically focused on the lower one, the cyber attacks on the middle two layers, the middle layer and the bottom layer. And these are attacks on confidentiality, integrity, availability, so the very classical cybersecurity. In recent years, focus in cybersecurity research also shifted a bit to the top, where you see here disinformation, information operations, cybercrime. And that's simply because actually at the top, there's often no IT involved, no exploits, no vulnerabilities. Yeah, think about someone who wants to disinform a country ahead of an election. What they do is they really disinform by spreading false news and so on. And IT actually can help a lot in coping with this, but it's not a classical cyber attack. The same for service. In many cases, actually, cybercrime is not breaking into any system. It's just misusing the system as it is. And in this respect, it's not a cyber attack, but still it's something where IT can actually help with fraud detection, with identifying attacks. Good, so what are we doing? So this is not a complete list, but a few examples. So for instance, starting at the top, fake news detection, what we do is we use natural language processing techniques to automatically analyze blog posts, news posts, and try to identify which ones are more likely fake news, so disinformation, than real news. And of course, this is, I have to say, a dangerous thing because it smells a bit like censorship, which we don't want. And what it really does is actually you don't identify fake news, but you identify the typical style of fake news, which is typically very emotional, very heated. And this can then be used by journalists, for instance, when they do an investigation to differentiate between serious news and not so serious news. Blockchain for industry 4.0, for the industrial internet. I mean, there's not much I can say about it other than what I just said. Everybody's talking about blockchain. Blockchain is a nice way, an efficient way to secure transactions, and in particular in industry 4.0, where it's about connecting industry, connecting suppliers. It's quite important to do this in a very trustworthy, very robust way, and so blockchain is actually a quite natural choice. We do a lot of anomaly detection and security for the Internet of Things. At the bottom, this measurement, secure routing, secure identification, is actually what I showed you. So we have several projects where we actually analyze the whole internet for known vulnerabilities, for unknown vulnerabilities. So we really try to make a map of which is more secure, which is not so secure. But we don't stop there. Of course, identifying that the domain name system is not secure is interesting, but not very constructive. We also come up with better proposals on how to improve routing, and how to improve, for instance, the identification done for PKI kind of certification. We do this in a way so that actually it works with the current technology. This is quite important also for this topic of security at large. So it's easy to come up with a new internet which is more secure than the current internet, but nobody would use this new internet. What you have to come up with, you have to come up with solutions which actually work in the current internet, which can be deployed continuously, which can be employed in small steps, and which offer actually benefits to those who deploy it. And if you think about it, most security technology actually doesn't work like this. Most security technology offers a lot of benefits for everybody, not just for those who deploy. And it typically offers this benefit only if there is high market penetration, like if 90% of the population use it. And this doesn't work in real life. So we have to be much more efficient and do things in steps. This is what we do there. On the left, code inspect, EpiCapture, agile cryptography. So what's behind this? There's a lot of software testing, but the last one, agile cryptography, for instance, is a project where we try to help enterprises to transform their crypto environment so that it's robust even if quantum computers become reality. This is called post-quantum cryptography. It's actually just an engineering problem in some sense, but actually it's a difficult engineering problem. I mean, if you look at how software is written today, how cryptography is deployed, it's a bit of a chaos, and it's not at all easy in an enterprise to replace cryptography of one type by the other type. So it's a lot of engineering for this, and a lot of crypto research in coming up with efficient post-quantum cryptography. Post-quantum cryptography actually means it's normal, classical cryptography, but provably secure even against quantum computer attackers. Good, and last but not least, top left, Volksverschlüsselung, Landabor Cybersicherheit. This is pointing to the people box, and these are actually two projects where we really try to help people with better security. LernLabor, that's the Learning Lab Cybersecurity. This is a Fraunhofer initiative where a couple of institutes came together and are now offering courses on advanced security topics to people in the job already, so training in the job. And Volksverschlüsselung, People's Encryption, that's a project where we actually offer certification services for like PKIs, kind of certification services for email, for anything on the internet, for private use, free of charge. And it comes with an application that takes care of all the management. So if you are a private person and you don't want to deal with the crypto details, with keys and things like this, all you need to do is you have to install the software. It's taking care of the interaction with the certification authority. It's doing everything for downloading certificates and so on. And then it's deploying the keys on all the software on your system, which can deal with encryption. And then you are in business, you can communicate with everybody else who is in this Volksverschlüsselungs infrastructure. Good. If you want to read more about what we think is important, what Fraunhofer thinks is important, I'm just recommending three reports. One is from 2014, Cybersecurity 2020. That's the strategy of Fraunhofer Society for Cybersecurity Research. It's still valid. I mean, 2020 is still a few years ahead. And then there are these three cybersecurity research centers and a couple of other research centers in Germany, which came together and wrote these reports. So one is on a strategy for Germany, and the other one is on key challenges in IT security and research. So just if you're interested, I recommend downloading them and reading them. And with this, thank you very much for your attention. And if you have time, I'm happy to take
questions. Thanks a lot. Yes, now is the time where we'll answer, well, you will answer, hopefully, some of those burning questions that you guys have, if you do. So if you have a question, I'll come around with a mic. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Is quantum computing, does that pose an additional threat, or is that a tool that you can eventually use to fend off these threats?
In general, in IT, quantum computers are a great thing. Yeah, it's a new opportunity to solve problems much more efficiently than before. From a security perspective, actually, it's really primarily a threat to cryptography. So quantum computers can't run arbitrary algorithms. There's only a handful of algorithms which actually work at the moment. And unfortunately, two of them break almost all modern public key cryptography. So if you think about RSA, Diffie-Hellman, all of these things, elliptic curve cryptography, that's all going down the drain if and when quantum computers become reality, which is maybe 10, 20 years away from us, maybe never, who knows. The good news is that actually since a couple of years, there's also a research discipline in cryptography, which I mentioned, is post-quantum cryptography. And post-quantum cryptography is classical cryptography, so it's not quantum algorithms, it's algorithms which are running on normal laptops and normal PCs and normal servers, but their mathematical background, their mathematical foundation is different from like RSA or so. It's based on lattices and whatnot. And these things can't be broken with quantum computers easily. So it's quantum computers are a threat to security, but it's not the ultimate end of cryptography. It just needs a new type of cryptography. the other question for security, there's nothing yet where quantum computers improve security. There's quantum cryptography, that's yet a completely different thing. There's nothing to do with quantum computers. But so to speak, I'm looking forward to quantum computers for their efficiency, but we have to take care that cryptography doesn't break with them.
Thank you.
Please, I would like your opinion about my statement that cryptography might lock out people or devices. I set up a computer with Windows 2000 with the latest Firefox of 2012. And I just activated the computer and with Firefox of 2012, I was not able to address websites of Google, of GitHub, and of Apple. And it said, it looks like if the websites are not available, because the implemented algorithms, so the protocols, TLS, were too low. So if you buy a device which works for 30 years and which cannot easily be updated because of memory, of CPU power, whatever, so after a few years it is worthless. Let's say a Buka computer with Windows 95, something like this. So it must be thrown away just because others said, oh, well, we want cryptography, we want secure protocols, which might be useful, but so we don't accept you. So so everything gets worthless because it cannot be adopted to the following strength.
So actually, I mean, this is exactly what I meant with agile cryptography, which is the term for it. So you have to have mechanisms to update cryptography to the new level. And then, I mean, you're 100% right. If you have a system which can't be updated, which is dangerous anyway, but if you have a system which cannot be or should not be updated, then in a few years, probably, it will be completely useless because it can't participate in modern transaction systems of any type. That's true.
Any more questions? Yes, sir, coming over. Thank you.
You mentioned that you have a project for securing people. So if you can give us more details about that project, is it sort of security awareness or how you secure
You have to. People? Can you repeat the last sentence?
Yeah, is it a matter of security awareness programs or what sort of projects you provide to secure people?
So we do also work in security awareness and training and so on. But actually the two ones I mentioned is, so Volksverschlüsselung People Encryption, that's a usability project. So we want to make cryptography usable, improve the user interfaces, increase the amount of, increase the automation level so that people don't have to think about stuff which can be taken away from them. They can focus on the real security questions, like do I want to communicate with this person or not? But not do I have the key and things like this. This is Volksverschlüsselung. That's the usability. And the other kind is going towards awareness, but not just awareness, actually knowledge. There is, in this country certainly, but I think in all countries, there's a tremendous demand for professionals with a security background. Not even security professionals, certainly that's true, but for IT professionals who know enough about security for their job. And what Fraunhofer did is we started this learning lab, cybersecurity, as one way to do this. So this is spread all over Germany. So from like Sachsen to Baden-Württemberg or so, from top there. And we offer like 40, 50 courses on different aspects of cybersecurity, not the basic stuff. I mean, the basic stuff you can get almost anywhere on the internet, but on specific topics like automotive security, like embedded system security, how to use paths and things like this, like detailed stuff. And I think that's quite important. We need to get this into the existing workforce, into people who are actually all in the job already.
Thank you so much. Thanks for inspiring us.
It was my pleasure.
Here today.
Thank you very much.
And big round of applause, please. Thank you.